It's good to see you again. Pull up a chair by the hearth.
Alright guys, this is the grand final of the Auckland Fireside Gathering Championship Stage 1. I'm joined by Pixie and I am Avril, otherwise known as Kevin. How are you guys doing tonight? This is a cast for the grand final, Ting Tong versus RKL. How are you doing, Pixie?
Yeah, I'm pretty good. This was a really, really interesting tournament all across the board, actually, and I'm really psyched to have these two guys in the final. This is going to be a really cool match. So to give you guys a little bit of a background, this is the top 16 players from previous tournaments that are duking it out to basically have their shot at going to Worlds this year at BlizzCon, which is actually pretty huge for, you know, small town New Zealand. It's been really hot competition, hasn't it?
Yeah, so this is hosted by Aspect of Gaming, and basically this is a Blizzard-sanctioned tournament where the winner can have the chance to basically go to regionals and have a chance to qualify for BlizzCon World Champs. So, you know, crazy stuff could happen here. You know, the winner of this could potentially really move on somewhere. And we've got the top two out of 16 players, the best 16 players, I might say, I personally think, in Auckland. And you've got RKL, who I think is a veteran of the tournament scene. Sorry, got a little bit of a bug going on here, a bit of a spectator bug, excuse that, but yeah, RKL, who is, you know, a tournament veteran in the Auckland scene, he's been to a lot of, especially the Aspect Gaming tournaments, he's played online as well, and then we've got Ting Tong, fresh newcomer. This is actually his first tournament, and here he is all the way in grand finals.
Yeah, Ting Tong is quite interesting, actually. He like you said, he sort of came out of nowhere, so there was a wild card entry into this on top of the other tournament entrants who, like we said, were winners of previous tournaments, or at least high placed in previous tournaments. And Ting Tong was sort of a little bit to the side of that. He kind of had to pitch himself and made his way in, and he's really shown his stuff. You know, he's proven that he was certainly worthy of that slot. Yeah, let's get into this game.
I mean, so here we go. Ting Tong is playing it's actually a hybrid hunter. Just from previously checking decklist, so Ting Tong is going with the hybrid hunter versus RKL's pretty much oil rogue with a gang up. It's like a gang up oil rogue. He has one gang up in this
deck. Spiciest oil rogue I've ever seen.
It's slippery, man. It's slippery. You get them gang ups in there, it's pretty slippery. We're on to turn four already, so we did have a bit of a spectator bug where we missed the opening couple of turns, and we'll guess we'll just open from turn three. Basically, you had Animal Companion into Haunted Creeper, killed by Deadly it's killed by Eviscerate, and now onto RKL's fourth turn with one charge left on this Deadly Poison Dagger.
Yeah, that I can see this being a smart turn to use the coin, just because you have so much efficient removal as rogue. One of the only problems we are having right now, of course, is we actually can't see RKL's hand, which is a little bit of a shame, but we do have everything Ting Tong has. And I was going to say, he's also very heavy on his 5-drops, RKL. Mm-hmm. He actually runs, if I'm not mistaken, 2 Sludge Belchers and 2 Azure Drakes. It might just be 1 Drake, but he has a considerable number of 5-drops prep fan. That's a really nice turn for him, actually. Get a Belcher down. He's still got that charge on his dagger.
Yeah, so RKL's got Antique Healbot, 2 Drakes, a Lothib, and 2 Belchers, so he's very heavy on the turn 7. Turn 5, my apologies. Ting Tong with Hybrid Hunter, it's really he loses a bit of the push from the early turns, but you know, really we're going to see what he can bring through the later turns of Hybrid Hunter. I did see it fall off the ladder just a little bit, and the win conditions are a bit iffy because you are still trying to go for face, but it's just not as fast with a little bit of a mid-range upbeat going on there.
Yeah, you do also have to be careful about what is on the board, which is somewhat uncharacteristic of Hunter. That was a really tricky turn for him, actually, whether or not to play the Weapon or the Wolf Rider. A lot of people have been teching in Acidic Swampoos. Pretty much every deck actually has had one of those in it.
Ting Tong has one in this one. Ting Tong has it in this deck.
Absolutely. There was only one Harrison, I believe, which came out in a previous match, but aside from that, there was one or two players that didn't have an Ooze and everyone else has, so that's a bit of a risky play, but at the same time, you know, with the Wolf Rider, you're afraid of so many other things, and this is a really interesting Lothep turn.
Well, the thing is, you know, the argument for playing it is that Arkel spent his Fan and Knives, so, you know, Fan and Knives is gone, he's got a 3-1 dagger. You know, I actually think maybe the Wolf Rider would have been a better play just because you would have either had to force Arkel to play his dagger into your wolf, or, you know, and there's somewhat of a low risk of another Phantom Knife, so it might have been a better move, but actually he's still doing pretty good. He's managed to combo Wolf Rider with Abusive Stargens to push out the extra 5 damage, a 3 again on top of Eagle Hornbow, and now Arkel's sitting on 9, so this is getting crazy low now.
Yeah, people always rag on the Hunters, don't they, for having a lack of decision-making, but actually right there you see the decision-making in action. Mm. It's, you know, do you actually run that 5-1 into the Lothep? You know, you have to respect the Lothep. It's a big, scary body, especially, I was about to say, with things like oil that can come out, you know, a good oil Fan and Knives with the Lothep still out could have been a really terrifying situation, but he's held on, and, oh, I think that's... No, he doesn't have enough mana for the whole load of those spells. He's just going to have to... I think he has to quick shot out the Lothep, the enemy Lothep, rather. And yeah, I think playing his Lothep is correct here. And just
well, either way, Arkel's gonna trade into this Lothep no matter what. So, you know, if he does quickshot out the Arkel's Lothep, if Ting Tong quickshots out Arkel's Lothep, it means the Belcher has to trade into it. Or, you know, there has to be some sort of eviscerate spell power thing coming out next turn. It's definitely getting to the stage where it's a bit dangerous for Arkel to do any more face damage with his weapon. This is kind of the weakness in Rogue in this matchup, is you really have to be careful how you use your weapon to remove, because it's costing you life.
One of the interesting things as well about Arkel's deck is he isn't running Southsea deckhands. And wow, actually, there's the use we were talking about. But like I said, he doesn't run Southsea deckhands, so he loses the quick kind of bursty win condition that a lot of oil rogues use. He does have to have things down on the board, so trading away the Sludge Belcher potentially hurts his ability to get that bursty turn if he can survive out the next turn.
I definitely think Arkel's playing more for the late game, because he's running Dr. Boom, which is very good. It's somewhat 50-50 for a lot of oil decks. A lot of oil decks won't run it, a lot of oil decks will. But then on top of that, he's running a gang up, which is for a deck like this, which isn't trying to mill your opponent. He's looking to do something like a gang up Dr. Boom, or gang up Azor Drake, or gang up Sludge, or something like that, right?
Yeah, but he's going to have to be doing it in a different game, because that is lethal. Actually, playing that SI7 agent ended up costing him the game there. It gave Ting Tong the extra hounds to eke out the lethal. Mm. And that's going to be game one going to Ting Tong now. The Hunter is off the board, as this is Conquest format.
Yep, that's right.
Arkel still has to eke out a win with that funky, funky rogue of his.
Hey, look, I didn't think the SI agent was a bad play. I mean, at that point, Arkel made the decision, look, I'm going to race Ting Tong. It's probably the win condition Oil's looking for. Oil does have the ability to race Face Hunter at times, but I don't think Arkel had the early damage to really be able to race. He started to catch up on damage towards the late game and just, you know, misses out because he added another minion for the hounds. But then again, hey, look, if that wasn't there, it's just one damage difference anyway. Arkel would have needed to find a win condition the next turn. It's putting a lot of pressure on the rogue with and I think he only had 2 or 3 cards left in the hand anyway, so it's definitely a very difficult situation for Arkel either way to look at it.
Yeah, you're dead right. Like, he could have assumed that Ting Tong had Kill Command and Unleash the Hounds and only played the one minion, but even then, you know, he still had to find a lot of damage in the next turn, and for all he knew, it wasn't Kill Command and Unleash the Hounds. It was, you know, his second quick shot. There's so many things it could have actually been, and
swing turn,
playing around it didn't keep him alive long enough.
Yeah, the swing turn in that game was for sure Iron Beak Owl on the Sludge. I mean, that essentially shuts down your entire turn 5, right? I mean, you spend a turn playing down Sludge Belcher, gets instantly shut down the next turn by an Owl, and, you know, that one play wins games for Face Hunters. Even though this isn't technically a Face Hunter, it really wins games for Hunters in general, I think.
Yeah, which is really the risk of including that as a 5-drop in Rogue. You know, often they get by with just the Azure Drakes, because actually the spell damage in the card cycle is more important. Rogues don't play a slow, stally kind of game. Like, they stall through controlling the board, sure, but it's not so much like putting down minions and
I don't even think
up.
I don't think Belch is even a standard in Oil Rogue. I think this was maybe a tech choice for
RKL
in this tournament. He's got some interesting decisions with his rogue lineup. It's got the skeleton of an Oil Rogue with some other stuff. He's not going to be playing that Oil Rogue though, because he's going to go into his Warrior deck. It's a patron versus Tempo Waker.
I really like the Flame Waker in Tempo Mage, because it can be... It just gives it that one extra kick into gear as far as the aggression on the board goes, you know? You can get one good Flame Waker turn, and it just transforms the game. Whereas otherwise with Tempo Rogue, you're really relying on everything going really, really well every single turn. Mm-hmm. And, you know, getting the right cards in all the right order. Whereas this way, you can... I don't want to go so far to say as you can fall behind tempo, but it's like falling behind tempo doesn't suddenly cost you the game as extremely as it otherwise would.
Ting-tong's,
and it gets frostbolted, I think.
Ting-tong's mage here actually does a really good job of the late game. It's actually a very late game oriented deck. He's running Toshli, Archmage, Antonitis, and Boom in this deck, so he's got a few more late game win conditions than the typical Tempo Waker deck. And what a great opening, right? He's got straight into the mirror image. It's one of the hardest openings for Warrior to deal with, any sort of Warrior, really.
Do you trade that away? I think he is going to go for that. He wants to hold the Frostbolt until his Flame Waker turn. But yeah, you're dead right. He almost plays it a bit like a hybrid of Tempo and Grinder Mage. He doesn't quite have the same approach of, you know, Belches and Sentience with Duplicate, but... You know, he has all the spare parts synergy with the Toshli and the Antonitis in there, and even just getting, you know, cheap spells with Sorcerer's Apprentice on the board. So he again, it's just another way that Tempo Mage can almost afford to fall behind it just briefly. You know, they can't fall behind massively, but yeah, it gives him that late game.
I think Patron's got a decent matchup against Tempo Waker, just certainly because the Patrons, you know, if you play Waker into Patrons, you can't really clear. That becomes suddenly quite dangerous, doesn't it? And I don't know what... I'm going to really check quickly what AoE Ting-tong is running, if any.
I think he has a Flamestrike.
No, he does not. He does not have a Flamestrike, because removals, Arcane Missiles, and Flame Cannon, two Frostbolts and two Fireballs. Once the patrons start flowing, Ting-tong has no answers to that. Has no answers to that.
This is really huge, actually, because he can Frostbolt out the enemy Acolyte and ping his own, so he guarantees himself a card off that, and quite likely gets the second one out of that, so that's actually really huge for him.
This does stall the patron, but you are losing damage. Like, once again, I'm saying, you know, Ting-tong doesn't have much removal, and once the patrons start flowing, he's really, really not got a lot to work with. But, you know, what about the Frothing Berserkers? You know, maybe you want to save a Frostbolt for one of those. If you don't have a Frostbolt for one of those, you're going to have to spend a Fireball to remove the Frothing Berserker, so... Patron has a really massive swing turn in this game if Patron can get the ball rolling, which, you know, with the amount of card draw that deck generally has, I would say it's quite likely, although Ting-tong's did manage to shut down the first Acolyte, so we'll see how they go.
Also, it's quite a crucial thing, but the Acolyte did end up going face, so now RKL, if worst comes to worst, can cycle a Battle Rage for 2 mana, draw that one card off his own damage. You can't call that a misplay. You can't call it
really...
a misplay by Ting-tong, but it is a little
It's a choice. It's a choice. Yeah. It's not a misplay, but it is a choice. Execute out of two gone. So if this game goes late, there's not going to be another execute for something like an Archmage Ancientitis, which is, you know, going to be pretty crucial at that stage. And I don't know. I'm kind of not too fond of going for a War Axe on the mirror image, because here's the thing. When you put the Frothing Berserker down, you want the opponent to have as many minions as you can, so we can go for that massive whirlwind play. It's going to clear both of those images and add some extra damage. So, and they're not even a real threat, and you're not going for any sort of face damage now anyway. You're probably just stalling to get your combo out there, and you can finish your opponent off with 30 damage in a turn easy. So, no rush to clear the images, in my opinion.
The thing is, though, you can imagine that at this point, RKL, he knows he's playing against a Tempo Mage. He's not going to be assuming that there is the late game in this deck like the Antonitis and the Toshli. He it was probably quite comfortable using that execute just to deny the second card to leave them on equal footing.
The execute's fine. It's the fire with War Axe I'm not too sure about.
I think you're right. That is a potentially questionable play. But at the same actually, what else in this deck do you War Axe? You've seen one of the Sorcerer's Apprentices, so you know that that's out of the picture. You haven't seen Mana Worms. Flamewaker's a bit too beefy. They have to be hit by Deathspite. I'm not sure. I think it's actually hard to say when else you're going to use the axe.
I guess, you know, that's a good point too. I'm more thinking along the lines of it's not crucial to remove the images in this matchup purely because you're trying to stall anyway, and, you know, having the images on the enemy side when you do a Whirlwind Frothing play is just going to give you more damage and is going to clear them anyway just because they're already on one health. That's sort of more along the lines of where I'm thinking, but, you know, what the advantage it does give to Arkale now is Ting Tong can't play his Flamewaker, unless, of course, he's then going to taunt his Toshley, in which case then he can play his Flamewaker.
That's actually not too bad a play here. He would ideally want to clear the Gnomish Engineer, though. Sorry, Gnomish Inventor, which would leave Toshley on 5 health. Which is a little unfortunate.
The Inventor's optional. Like, what's the Inventor gonna do? It's not a big threat. I would kind of maybe even think about leaving that.
I think the only reason you would clear it, I mean, you said it yourself, the more minions that are on the board, you know, the more potential things there are. Wow, he knows where that Flamewaker hits. But yeah, the more things that are on the board, the more procs there are when your Frothing Berserker comes out. And when there is that Death Spite up, you
Jesus
want to minimize
Christ.
What's getting hit. Wow, that's...
Ting Tong is like... I've seen a few people in the tournament so far say his RNG is incredible. His RNG is incredible, and a few people have said that. His knives that he juggles in the Flamewaker RNG, just everything goes his way. Even the implosions, like... Who was it that said he basically gets 4 every time?
Yeah, except for one time he was playing against a hunter and he needed to not kill the minion and he rolled a 2. It's Ting Tong.
It's like he gets to choose, right? It's like he gets to choose.
Oh
which,
yeah, it's what he actually gets the druid options whenever he plays a spell.
Right?
He gets little druid options.
And you could even argue Unstable Portal he gets to choose, because who gets an Ancient Mage as a Tempo Waker? What, now he gets 2 spell power on... He's sitting on a Missiles, which is now going to hit for 5, plus another 2 from the Flame Waker. That's almost is 1 damage off a Avenging Wrath, basically, for 1
yeah.
mana.
I don't think I've ever actually seen Ancient Mage be so important. And that's really saying something.
This is not happy times for Arkale. I mean, that's almost as bad as, you know, someone getting a really amazing legendary out of an unstable portal.
Yeah, okay, that being said though, Acolyte Armorsmith is quite a nice counter. I mean, he doesn't really deal with what's on the board there, but it is an okay counter. Mm-hmm. You don't want to use the Flamewaker. Sorry, you don't want to
use
the Flamewaker up.
He's just going to remove it with the Toshley. Which I then guess also prevents him from taking 5 damage to the face. So, kind of either way, I do see how it does work for him here.
Of a bad situation, you know?
What I want to know is, does he go for the Antonitis Arcane Missiles? He could do that, but he may be open to a second execute if Arkale decides to go for the damage for the Deathbite.
Because I wonder if he actually wants the Toshley to die first. That seems like a little bit of a misplay as well, actually, letting the extra card get drawn from the Acolyte there, especially as he's approaching.
Oh man,
turn
he's
eight.
Going straight into the fireball, that
wow.
8 damage fireball.
He's up for it. Do you Arcane Missiles here as well? I think you must.
No. You want to save the missiles for your Antonitis. You need something to start generating Antonitis flat fireballs. If you don't have a generator, it's really becomes a bit of a dead card. Or it's not a dead card, but it's just you're not using it to its potential.
The thing with that, though, is, you know, with the clear board and with the Arcane Missiles, that actually becomes 1 mana, deal 7 damage, which is pretty insane, and you will get a spare part from Toshley, most likely. I think that you're right, though, he's saving it for the Antonitis, but you almost wonder
turn
if
turn 8, by the way. This is the big patron turn.
Especially with all that on the boards.
Oh, man.
That is going to get pretty scary.
How many people? it begins.
Oh, there's so many things with two starts. Attack there. This is a dream board.
It's, oh my god, it begins. Oh. This is what I'm telling you the whole time. As soon as the patron finds his combo, it's like, Ting Tong has no answer to this. He has no flame strike. He has nothing. You can't even play arcane missiles here. You're just going to make his board even bigger. I don't know what options Ting Tong has. He has to close out the game. He has to draw into fireball.
Yeah, what even saves
something.
Him here?
Nothing really, to be honest. Wow, look at that board. Absolutely it's clear. And the rope is struggling. The rope is like, just
it's
trying to
burning
run out.
And
It's burning for a while. I'm surprised he's got everything in there.
I think you're dead here no matter how you slice it. He'll probably just play down the Antonitis. Or actually, I think you don't because... Oh, he's going to go for it.
Maybe you were right.
Arkale doesn't know that there's the Antonitis there. Like, maybe that's a bit of a misplay because this is going to go to another
game.
This is
over.
Tricky play. The other patron.
I think you might have been right. Consider if he played the 7 damage arcane missiles the turn before. That would have taken Arkale down another, 7 health. And then if he top decked a fireball, that would have been it, right? What did he actually top deck? I didn't actually notice, but...
I think it was his second mana worm, I think he top decked. I could be wrong.
You're right. It was a second mana worm. But let's say it was the second fireball. He could have snatched that game. Snatched that game.
And the thing is, when you're coming up to Patron Warriors turn 8... You actually have to start assuming they have the combo. It's the same thing you get with playing around Flame Strike
and,
on your turn 6. Like, you just have to assume that they have combo. So pushing for the damage there would have been the correct play. You can't sit there and go, well, if he doesn't have combo, then I still have plenty of time to kill him. Because that's true.
I think the bigger argument is that you can't top deck into a Flame Strike. So let's say he does have the combo, well, you instantly lose, don't you? So you have to sort of play in a sort of all-in fashion where, you realize that you don't have a clear for the patrons, you have to push for damage to win. So, maybe that was the right... He didn't end up top-ticking Fireball anyway, so he would have still lost. But you got to play for the best chance to win, and that would have probably been the best chance to win in that situation.
Yeah, definitely, yeah. Well, in any case, it does even up our series here, so... Ting Tong has won with his Hybrid Hunter, and on the flip side of that, Arkale has won with his Patron Warrior, so it is going to be...
Tempo Waker versus...
Nice.
I'm pretty sure it's Zoo.
I believe it is Zoo. We've seen quite a few different kinds of Warlock, actually, this tournament, and Ting Tong himself, his third deck is Demon Lock.
Ting Tong...
It's the
Ting
only
Tong
Demon
Zoo.
Lock we've seen so far.
Are you talking about this deck? Oh, wait, hang on. Arkale's Zoo is standard Zoo, but it does have a Sea Giant. It's got Jiraxxus Mal'Ganis Sea Giant as the sort of kicker card.
It's sort of a spicy hybrid. Like, not quite Zoo, but
no,
in that direction.
It's not really. It'd have to go for... It's almost there. It's pretty much there, I'll say. It's pretty much there. And interestingly enough, I remember someone else in the tournament made a comment, something like, what is this deck? He just randomly plays Jiraxxus? Am I suddenly playing against Handlock? Like, what kind of Warlock am I going up against? It's so confusing.
You're going up against all of them. You got every kind of Warlock. There's demons.
Even corruptions
zooming in
there.
Hell, just play a Malygos,
Even
six
demons is in there, right?
it's actually every Warlock deck rolled into one. It says a lot, though. We've seen 4 different kinds of Warlock deck at this tournament. We've seen a bit of Handlock, seen a bit of Malylock, we've seen the Zoo, we've seen the Demon. There's so many potentially viable Warlock decks, and it's really
Can I just say how ridiculous a Ting Tong start here is? Double Mana Worm into Coin, Flame Waker, Arcane Missiles. The only thing he's missing is the Mirror Images.
Now what
and
you do
he's
here is
even
Ting
got
Tong.
And he's even got a Flame Cannon to deal with that.
I was going to say, what you do is you play Arcane Missiles because you know that you're going to hit the Knife Juggler, but no, this was better.
I don't know. You don't necessarily know that.
But you are Ting Tong.
Oh, yeah. You are Ting Tong, so what ends up happening? Yeah, pretty much.
But you don't want to risk it. You don't want to risk that not happening. Then you end up losing your Mana Worm. So that is the correct play.
So now I'm guessing he doesn't want to play the Arcane Missiles. That would be a bit tricky. What he could do here is he could flame wake a coin mana worm, but then you'd risk opening up the egg, so it becomes a bit weird. Playing mirror image here is a bit iffy as well, because when egg comes down, the next card that usually follows is something like an abusive sergeant, right? So you're gonna end up copying an abusive sergeant, which is kind of bad.
Yeah, well, depends. There was potentially an argument actually to intentionally pop the egg open, go Flamewaker, crack it open with your Mana Worm, and then coin Arcane Missiles, because then you've got a fairly good chance of killing the drop from the egg, or even going the other way around and using the worm second. But against copying the Flame Imp is pretty nice here.
Like, yeah, I was going to say, against the Zoo, copying in a Flame Imp is not bad, because you get... He plays one mana, but you get like a two mana worth card, and he takes three damage and you don't. So that's actually pretty good.
He's got a much better turn this turn as well, potentially, with Arcane Missiles, and I think he has to
clear.
Worm.
He has to clear this Nerubian here, because if Arcane Missiles don't hit favorably... And let's say they only do like two damage out of the four, and your ping can't finish it off. In fact, you don't get to ping anyway. So let's say it takes three damage, and Nerubian's on 4/1. Then you got to trade something into it anyway.
Yeah,
and it's just a big waste. I would play the Flame Imp into the Nerubian here. It's one of the only ways.
You only need one thing to hit. You get seven shots if you coin Arcane Missiles here. You only want one of them to hit even.
And here's the thing, you got a pretty decent chance of killing a Flame Imp with 2 health. I don't know. Now he's opening up extra spiders. Now you're making it even harder to kill the Nerubian. Oh, this is what I'm talking about. If the Nerubian doesn't get killed here, you're going to get your thing cleared. You get your Flame Waker's gone. 4-1. Oh, no.
Ooh, that's so rough. And the Flame Imp is alive as well. All he did really was take one damage off his enemy's board there with the point Arcane Missiles.
Really, the worst part about this is Arkale gets such a favorable trade here. I mean, trades a 4-1 into Flame Waker. No-brainer. Trades a 3-1 Imp into a 3-3 Mana Worm. Another no-brainer. There's no way you don't make those plays this turn, and a 3-1 Flame Imp on your opponent's side, well, you can just Mortal Coil that later.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, Zoo doesn't have those nice AoE removals.
Ting-Tong made a risk there, man. That was a not a good risk.
I think that's the only time I haven't seen RNG pay off for him in some crazy way.
Maybe he was expecting RNG to pay off for him, which, if it did, would have been the craziest thing I've ever seen.
Oh,
but
it absolutely
you
would.
Can't. I don't know. You cannot be at tournament level. At tournament level, at grand final level, you cannot be playing those risks. I would not be taking those kind of risks at this time.
Yeah, at least if you can avoid taking them, you absolutely should. Well, this isn't actually a very good play here. Okay, the Argus makes it a lot better. I was gonna say that. It's still average.
I wouldn't even consider playing the Argus. You're just giving more value to this trade now. This Flame Imp gets a better trade because you Argused it. Whereas if it was just an abusive sergeant, it would have been an equal trade. In fact, I would even go as far as to say Ting-Tong wouldn't have made the trade at all. Would have just gone for the straight face damage.
It's not looking great. Also, with the Argus used up, he kind of loses a bit of an opportunity to taunt up something much more important later on, so he's gone all in.
I'm surprised he didn't go for the instant kill on the Imp Gang boss, but then again, 5 damage to the face is pretty good. What this actually is doing now is it's kind of bluffing Arkale into believing Ting-Tong's holding double fireball.
Well, the other thing is,
this is what I would be thinking.
He knows that Zoo doesn't really have AoE. Like, he's not going to see a Hellfire out of here. And what else is Zoo going to do on turn 7? Like, he can basically Doomguard and throw out the rest of his hand, which leaves Ting-Tong ahead.
Yeah,
what he's
say
got on the board, plus Frostbolt, or Azure Drake Frostbolt, is... You know, it's lethal. It's scary stuff.
Sometimes, especially at tournament level, you might tech in a Shadow Flame. Might, keyword might here. It's very rare, and I don't think Arkale does have it. But Ting-Tong managed to really come back a little bit with those two cards that couldn't be removed. And here we go. Arkale hasn't drawn a single implosion, has he? I think that's the difference right now.
Yeah,
no
well,
implosion.
Also, He didn't need to tap. I believe he actually already had that Doomguard in hand. If you look from where it was played, he didn't need to tap, and actually tapping just put him in lethal range.
Well,
there.
Yeah, but he needed to tap for options.
Oh no, sorry, I lied. That is not. He's not in lethal range. No. For some reason, I had it in my head that Frostbolt was actually a fireball.
I think he should Frostbolt now, because now he's going to miss out on the spell damage once the Drake gets removed.
And still going for it.
I'm fairly certain I would remove the Drake over the... Oh, man, I don't know. I would have removed the Drake over...
Yeah, you've got to have some respect for... Like, even Arcane Missiles could be scary at this point.
Oh, that was such a horrible potion.
Oh, that's painful to see. He does have the clear, though. He can
I think Arkael was going for the spare part. Maybe he was thinking, if I get a Taunt spare part, this could be really good. But then that's, I don't know, that's a 1 in 5. You really want to dice roll a 1 in 5? Like, maybe I'll get a Taunt spare part?
What actually happens is he'll Unstable Portal into Reckless Rocketeer and then ping for the win.
He's...
to the Toshley is probably the smarter play there, because
this is what I'm talking about. The random Jiraxxus. The random Jiraxxus out of nowhere. Suddenly the game changes and you see Molten Giants and like all sorts of, I don't know, Twilight Drakes coming out of nowhere, and you're like, what? What is this? What am I playing against?
But we were talking about this before, like, yeah. He's used one of his defenders now. Like, his Infernals are scary, but they're not going to stop the mage in its tracks. And the mage only has to do 15 damage.
Do you know what, Ting Tong just broadcasted to Arkael there? He just said to Arkael, I have no fireballs. Because if he had fireballs, he would have gone for it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
He would have gone for face.
That's very telling.
He just said, I have zero fireballs in my hand.
He can stall, though, actually. He had the Rusty Horn, so I think he's happy just stalling out for now, really pushing out
how
the
damage. How does he always manage to get a Rusty Horn on Toshley? How does he always manage to get that on Toshley? That's what I want to know. That's the second time now.
He didn't Frostbolt Jiraxxus as well, which I find quite interesting. Evidently, the... Well played, is he... He must not have lethal then, but I'm surprised
eight,
he didn't
nine,
Frostbolt
ten.
Face for the extra damage.
Ooh.
And also...
Ting Tong's on lethal, wow. Ting Tong...
Yeah. Ting Tong just takes it home. Does he do it with the mirror image? No, He's just gonna take it home. Not bad. Now watch as the Flame Waker gets the final shot in.
Nice.
There it goes.
I kind of wanted to see Arkael come back there with some Infernals and some ridiculous... See what I was talking about with that Defender of Argus? He should have kept it.
Yeah,
he should have kept it.
Yeah, when you're not actually Handlock and you're not running things like Sun Fury Protector, you know, you have such a limited number of taunts. The 6/6 body is scary. Like, there's no two ways about it. But
it's more...
you play Jiraxxus when you're in a tight spot if you're playing it in Zoo, and you do need something to...
Or if you get unlucky. If you get unlucky with your Voidcaller, then you play Jiraxxus. If you get unlucky with Voidcaller... And you get extra unlucky because the game goes all the way to turn 9. If you get that level of unlucky, then you have to play Jiraxxus from hand. But you don't plan for that. That's not what you plan for with a Zoo deck. With a Demon Zoo deck, you don't plan to have to do that. Because of that, he thinks, yeah, I'll just play the Defender of Argus. But I didn't think it was a good target. I mean, that Abusive Sergeant was going to die anyway. Why give it more value to Ting Tong's trade? You lose value in that trade, so why give him value in that trade? Maybe he just wants to put down a 2/3 body, but I don't know, a 2/3 body didn't really help him either, because it just ended up dying to a Lotheb, and is that what happened? It ended up dying and didn't really achieve much anyway, and the Lotheb took forever to kill.
The 2/3 was, it was from the Flamimb, actually, which is, in a way, negative value, because Ting Tong got the Flamimb off Mirror Entity. In a way, he got that Flamimb for free, you know, and it...
He paid 1 card and 3 mana, so it's as if he played the card himself. So basically, he paid 3 mana for a Flame Imp that doesn't deal 3 damage to himself. So that's a negative value mirror image, because you can get a 3/2 for 2, which does the same thing, so you paid 1 extra mana for nothing.
Did he not play that for 2 mana, though? Was that not a Sorcerer's Apprentice? Oh, well.
No, it was a turn 3
anyway.
Play. New game.
Actually, you're right, yeah. New game, new day.
Let's see what Ting Tong does with his Demon Zoo deck. I think Ting... There we go. I said there was going to be... Dude, seriously, Shadow Flame. I'm calling this right now. Some Zeus, man. Shadow Flame. I'm not joking.
It's been quite interesting, actually. A lot of the players at this tournament have played hybrid-style decks, and, you know, without wanting to tell them they're wrong, there comes a point where you start to call them into question the effectiveness of these sorts of decks. Sometimes they can be great
choices.
On ladder. Certainly. But sometimes they can be great on ladder just because they're a bit of a surprise, you know, when you're so used to facing Royal Rogue and suddenly he gangs up a Dr. Boom. And it can have a similar effect in
See,
tournaments.
That's the thing. It's better in tournaments, but not as good on ladder, I think, because ladder requires consistency. You're going to fool one opponent every now and then, but every... You know, because of the sheer amount of games you're playing, it adds up that it doesn't become as good as you think it does. Whereas in tournament, you play against less people.
After the first one, it stops being a surprise. But what I was sort of leading it towards is we haven't seen any of that from Ting Tong. He's played pretty straight up and down decks. You know, his Demon Zoo is what you'd expect out of a Demon Zoo. You know, it's got a bunch of demons in it. He's even running Bane of Doom. He's got Shadow Flame in there. He's got his Mal'Ganis. I don't actually think he runs Jiraxxus, but, you know, it's exactly what you'd expect out of a Demon Zoo. Whereas, you know, when we saw Arkael's Demon Zoo before, it was like a bit of Zoo, and then all of a sudden he's played Jiraxxus out of hand.
Well, Jiraxxus is fine as long as you've got Void Call. I mean, you don't actually ever want to play Jiraxxus from hand. You want to Void Caller it out.
Yeah, thing is, he played it more like a zoo. You almost wonder if it's more valuable for him to just include a card other than Jiraxxus, even a Dark Iron Dwarf maybe.
So the difference between their zoo decks is from the immediate, what I can immediately tell is Ting Tong runs Shadow Flame and Bane of Doom, whereas Arkael runs Sea Giant and Jiraxxus. Those are the key differences. There's probably a couple of other cards in there, but those are the key differences. And, you know, both have more sort of more handlock sort of feelings, and both of them also have more zoo sort of feelings in the sense that, you know, Sea Giant's better in a zoo deck because you're likely to get a lot of minions out with stuff like Implosion.
That was a really nice, not really, really nice, but that was quite a nice turn four, actually, out of the Rogue. They've done a fairly good job of controlling the board. Unfortunately, does leave the two imps out there, but... Can't win them all. It's going to get cleared, I think, with the imp. That's a good turn 4 by the Rogue into an even better turn 4 by the Warlock there, which is a little bit unfortunate for Arkael.
I almost think Abusive Sergeant could have been kept for Nerubian Egg, but that's sort of a choice you got to make, you know. Do you go for the removal now or not? Or here we go, the Bane of Doom.
Oh,
Bane
of
Summon Mal'Ganis.
Yeah, I was going to say, watch as it summons Mal'Ganis. Felguard. That's the Ting Tong play. Wow, that's actually really, really valuable there. That slows up the Rogue a lot, and he gets to play it without the drawback. That's not Mal'Ganis, but it's actually really good here.
So basically, you paid 5 mana for a 3 mana card, but you don't have the drawback. So you kind of paid 2 mana. Oh, I guess you also remove. So it's 5 mana. You pay 2 extra mana to remove and don't have a drawback. So yeah, it is worth it. You're right. So I would pay that. I would pay 5 mana to get a Felguard and remove.
Yeah. It's sort of like a 5 mana Ascension Shield Master that kills a 4/2. You know?
Yeah,
that's pretty good.
Not gonna lie, that's pretty decent. And you're right, it does sort of slow Arkael down, because now he can't, not that he would have been able to, but he can't sort of remove that Void Caller.
He can't even remove the Felguard efficiently. I mean,
no.
Do you hit it and use up the Eviscerate?
He has to backstab and then hit him, that's efficient. But,
That's such an unfortunate time to play Healbot.
Ting Tong's got to dump these bonus demons out, because Void Caller doesn't want to call out anything but Doomguard. And another taunt to come out. Yeah,
he really does just...
I think, definitely. You put your Void Caller in one. This is when you want to get your Void Caller low. If Phantom Knives come out, you get a free Doomguard. Brilliant.
Yeah, exactly. Well, you want it to die to, like you said, Phantom Knives or Blade Flurry, which is the other potential. And that's something that the Rogue could well have held
Blade
the weapon
Flurry,
for as well.
Blade Flurry would be so disappointing right now, because...
It leaves
an imp, and it leaves a Doomguard. You actually make the board stay worse for yourself if you play Flurry. It's one of those situations. You make the board worse.
He absolutely has to have fan. Like, it's really the only good answer here.
Man, this is slow.
It's going to be Dr. Boom, yeah.
This is slow.
It's slow and it's a little
risky. Tim Tong's going to go all face here. He's going to go 100% face here. And he's going to tap.
Yeah.
And the thing that sucks for RKL right now is he can't punish Zoo for tapping. In fact, any slow decks generally can't punish Zoo for tapping, which really sucks because it's as if the Zoo player just gets to get two cards every turn and you cannot punish him for it because you have to deal with the board. And you can't deal with the board and punish him at the same time unless you're crazy tempo.
Actually, here's a thought. He could run everything to face and then Shadow Flame is Void Caller to pull out a Doomguard. And seeing as he's playing the Voidwalker here, clears out the
Maybe.
Boom bots as well, and the Dr. Boom still gets slowed up by the taunt. Even if the taunt goes down to spells, that's only an injured Dr. Boom at that point.
I gotta say, doing that makes Arkell's Blade Flurry that much better.
It certainly
does. Because here's what's happening here, is by not giving away your board, you actually... Oh, wow, that sucks.
Gonna...
That sucks. Did you just... Oh,
gets an
imp
out of it,
sucks.
But that feels so unfortunate. Is going to clear the second boom
bot
as well.
Oh my god, 200 damage boom bots, and one of them helped Ting Tong developers board. That is going to be the worst boom bot RNG.
Doesn't go for the Shadow Flame, interestingly enough. I guess if you're going to clear the boom bots manually, you don't want to, but I feel like that's potentially a bit of missed damage.
He doesn't need to go all in though. That's the thing, he does not need to go all in. If he keeps this board state up, he naturally wins in a couple of turns. If he goes all in and then Arkell gets a massive Blade Flurry, he doesn't really have recovery from that. Whereas now, if his board gets Blade Flurry, he instantly gets a Doomguard out, he gets another Imp and an Arubian out, and he suddenly has another board state after AoE. So, this is what I'm going to talk about. Now you're going to have a Doom. He still has his board. And you can still pressure your opponent because of this.
He has to run the Dr. Boom into the Doomguard.
Absolutely.
That needs to be Eviscerate. I guess he had the Eviscerate. He had the answer there. It's not actually a terrible.
That is brutal.
It's the first time I've seen him play Sap all tournament. Actually, he only has one sap in that deck. Saw him play so many games, and sap would have won him so many games that he lost because never drew it. That's the first sap
he
I've
only
seen
has
him
one
play.
Sap. He only has one sap.
Wow.
The only way that play could have been more brutal is if Ting Tong played Doomguard out of his hand and then had it sapped. That would have been more
Speaking
brutal.
Of, this is such an awkward play for Ting Tong. I mean, he has to go for it. Ooh, he didn't lose the second
fine.
Doomguard.
I think that's
crucial.
Fine. I think keeping the second Doomguard definitely is crucial here. Any other cards were fine to lose, just not the second Doomguard. I would be kind of scared of Burst here. You know, Arkell could, if he gets a massive Sprint Oil turn, he can win in this turn. But that's
Drake.
Not going to happen.
It could be Oil still. It does not have it. And as I said, this is actually getting pretty scary.
This is really tight now. And
Hellfire Mortal Coil does save the board here. That's not it. That's gonna be not in time. Oh, if that had been one card sooner, that could have been a very different game.
I think
but
you
it's
play.
Gonna be, I think.
No, no.
Here's
the strategy. You play the Void Caller and hope your opponent BMs you.
yeah.
Hope he BMs you and you get a free Mal'Ganis. How amazing.
Well, there's potentially argument, I know you're not being serious, but there's potentially argument in not doing that in case the Mal'Ganis came out, because you don't necessarily want to give away that you have it. I mean, you probably do, but you don't want to give it away if you don't have to. But in any case, that's going to be the series evened up, if I'm not mistaken. We didn't see the gang up. We did not see the gang up get played. He's actually ganged up that Dr. Boom every other time he's played that Dr. Boom. So it's the first time it was a lonely single boom.
I think it's too slow. I think if you gang up your own Dr. Boom, like, what are you going to do? Draw into more Dr. Booms? But that's so slow. Like, I mean, if the game was going to last till fatigue, you'd probably win. You can't lose with four Dr. Booms, surely. But if the game doesn't go that far, then it's just too slow, in my opinion.
We are going to see for the final match, though, a Warlock mirror match. We have the...
Whose Warlock is better? Here we go.
I don't know. We have the more demon-heavy coming out of Ting Tong. And Arkale with his.
Is it?
Yeah,
not necessarily.
I haven't seen Voidcallers in Arkale's deck. I have seen the Doomguards, but I don't believe I've seen the Voidcallers.
He has two Voidcallers. I think they're equally they are as equally demon as each other, because if you think about the tech options, it's Jiraxxus instead of Bane of Doom. But basically, what Arkale is saying is, I'm not going to take the dice roll on Bane of Doom. I want to know I can put a Jiraxxus out there. I want to have guaranteed Jiraxxus instead of a RNG Jiraxxus.
Ting Tong, on the other hand, loves rolling dice, so that's what he's going to go ahead with. Keeps all his cards
and
as well.
Most of the time, he's done some good dice rolls so far. He must have loaded dice at this stage. Are they going to go for a complete mirror opening?
They absolutely are. How great is that?
This actually really slows down this matchup quite considerably, because the early plays, unless there's an abusive sergeant in hand, there's not a lot to do here. They're both gonna hit each other for one damage, and if you particularly want to slow it down, then you don't even bother attacking.
And I actually think the slower game benefits Arkale here because of cards like the Sea Giant, and also having Jiraxxus in there and Mal'Ganis. Ting Tong only has Mal'Ganis and Dr. Boom. Beyond that, it's just Doomguards. So
Ting Tong also doesn't have great Shadow Flame targets apart from Dr. Boom, but then again, having said that, against a Zoo matchup, you don't need a massive Shadow Flame target. You just need a sort of average one and you can clear Zoo's board out.
Ting Tong opened up his Voidwalker to the Direwolf Alpha clear there, which is a little bit unfortunate, I think, but wow, that's a nice implosion roll.
That's a bang in the middle. Bang in the middle. Just good enough. Just good enough.
Well, you can't get a bad roll off a Knife Juggler, which I guess is a nice thing, but still, that's a good number of imps, and he is going to be able to clear that taunt up for sure.
He's not going to coil it?
No. I think he views the Voidcaller as more powerful here, just because the only demon in his hand is the Doomguard. He still gets to clear up most of the board. It's Voidcaller, really. The egg is a non-card until something pops out of it.
This is really interesting. A lot of the times I wanna kill the Voidcaller early game. If there's a Voidcaller comes down on turn 3, I wanna kill it on my turn 3 or turn 4, because chances are they either don't have a good demon in their hand, or they have something like a Flame Imp or Imp Gang Boss, and that's okay to come out. It's way better than a Mal'Ganis or a Doomguard, so
yeah,
I would want to kill the Voidcallers early.
Certainly, yeah, and in a way, actually, the less demons you've seen, the safer it is to hit the Voidcaller, because at the end of the game, you've seen most of the demons, yo. The Imp Gang Bosses have been and gone, same with the Flame Imp, same with probably one or maybe even two
and
of the
only
Doomguards.
Things you haven't seen,
pull Mal'Ganis.
Yeah, the only thing you haven't seen is the Mal'Ganis and the Doomguard, and the funny thing is, I've called a few bluffs on some Zoo players I've seen, and kill the Voidcaller, and nothing comes out.
This is
a greedy but very intensely damaging play.
It goes at the end of your turn.
Yeah, that's right.
All right.
I was about to board.
For a moment,
I
thought, no way.
Ooh.
Oh.
Okay. No.
That's not a bad play for him though. Okay. The double power of overwhelming is actually pretty smart if you have no better play in your hand.
It puts the clock on Ting Tong now, because now Ting Tong has to trade. Ting Tong's in this sort of position now where he can't play it as if it was, a mirror. It feels more like Ting Tong has to play control now to come back in the game, whereas Arkale can repeatedly hit face for the rest of the game.
I think you Bane of Doom your own egg here, yeah. I mean, you get the Nerubian out of it, which
Succubus
is
is kind of average.
It's not what he was looking for, but it's still not bad, because now
no
if he does get his, if he gets his power overwhelmings, then he can really push out a lot of damage. Or actually, if he gets his Shadow Flame, that can basically knock out anything small that Arkale plays here. And Arkale is running out of cards.
But he gets a tap for free every turn now, whereas Ting Tong almost can't afford to tap. I mean, he can possibly now because he's got a board, but Arkale can sort of spend a couple of turns tapping and developing a board, while Ting Tong doesn't have the life to play with, but he does have the board, and I do believe the board is more important. So good, it was a really good sort of stabilization from Ting Tong with that one single Bane of Doom.
Yeah, Arkael, he's only got the one Doomguard left, so he needs to find another way to deal that extra 5 damage. I mean, he has cards in his deck that can do that. Oh wow, that's such an unfortunate
Again,
play.
Again, this is the second time we've seen this play.
I guess he's just pulling it out.
Yeah, well, this time I understand why, because he has to this time. He can't afford to take too much face damage here. And he's got to block out 4 damage minimum.
Yeah, the only problem is he doesn't have a one-turn lethal anymore. You know, he can't deal 10 damage out of hand. He's got no power overwhelming, so he's only got one Doomguard. And this gets cleared for free.
Plus,
Arkael doesn't have a Hellfire, so all he actually does is uses 2 cards to buy himself a turn.
Do you think Arkael went a bit too all-in with a double PO? Do you think maybe he should have just saved one PO? I almost think saving one of the POs would have... might have been a bit safer. But then again, his sort of hand doesn't... He's got no recovery right now, and now Ting Tong's got... developed 2 big taunts.
Yeah,
Well,
I guess he just didn't have a better play. I think one would have been fine. I think you're right there, actually, but it's going to be the second Doomguard, and that's just going to end up clearing a taunt, which is a little bit painful here.
See, if he had the second PO and the taunts went there, he could sort of... even that's only 9 damage still.
That Healbot's going to push him out of range as well. No, he's just going to go for the boom. He's going to go for the aggressive play. I guess he can clear the Doomguard. He's feeling pretty comfortable even with his low health there. Actually, that's the second Doomguard. So he knows Arkael is all out of burst, and he's still 2 turns away from Jiraxxus.
I don't know what you can top deck here.
I think this is it.
Because he doesn't run Shadow Flame, and even then he doesn't have a good target, so there's nothing he can top deck here that I believe they could save him.
Hasn't found the card either, was fishing for it with that last
This
pack,
could be it.
But...
Oh, Ting Tong!
Oh, goes with the surrender. That is the GG, well played, and Ting Tong, it looks a little bit rough, but he was actually in pretty good shape despite his low health. Ting Tong winning the Warlock versus Warlock mirror matchup, and he takes away the victory today.
Oh man, what a long night it's been as well. This was a live event too. This wasn't an online tournament. These players actually came out to play in person. I mean, these guys are actually literally sitting across from each other. You know, they can see each other's faces almost, and the intensity going on. In a grand final with, you know, it's a best of 5 conquest, and you're down to the final 2. It's such a tough match, and it's just so intense between these players, especially it being live versus online. You get that extra level of intensity.
Yeah, something has to be said about that as well, because Arkael is sitting there with a huge smile on his face, and he's had that smile pretty much since the moment he sat down at his computer right at the top of the day. So, you know, real props to these guys for, you know, keeping positive throughout the entire thing, and that's a very gracious Arkael there.
I do feel a bit sorry for Arkael, because he's somewhat become the second place champion now. He's consistently placed really highly in tournaments, but he has never come first, and that's really disappointing. He's just come so close to getting that first place. He came second in the last online tournament as well, and he just barely lost it out. Not the last online tournament, the last Fireside Gathering, he just barely missed out again. So props to Arkael for coming along to all of these and, you know, doing exceptionally well at pretty much every tournament. But Ting Tong, out of nowhere, this guy...
The first tournament.
He's never played a tournament.
And he's going to be getting his name engraved on that beautiful Hearthstone Fireside Gathering trophy that we have knocking about the circuit here. His name is going to be immortalized on that plaque forever. And he also gets his shot at Worlds at BlizzCon later this year. I believe he has to go to Australia first.
So he's going to get an invite to second stage of Fireside Championship, which will be an online tournament hosted by Blizzard. And if he makes it to the top 4 of that, he gets invited to the Fireside Stage 3 Finals, where all 4 of the players invited are guaranteed cash prizes. You win cash no matter what at that stage of the tournament, and the winner of that gets a direct invite to the Australian New Zealand regionals. And
from there you go to Asia Qualifiers, and from Asia Qualifiers you're on to BlizzCon. So the path is definitely real, and this path was kind of designed to allow players who don't have the tournament points, who don't really have the opportunities to be playing in every single tournament collecting points or to be finishing top 100 legend every season, to give them a shot at, you know, basically being a wildcard entry to regionals and possibly going on to BlizzCon. And who better to have a wildcard entry into regionals than the wildcard dark horse player himself, Cheng Tong.
Yeah, the absolute props to him. He really played exceptional. Went 3-0 in most of his games leading up to this nail biter of a final series. Thank you so much, everybody who has tuned in today. I have been Pixie, and casting with me today has been Avril. You will no doubt be hearing from us in future, and hopefully we'll get to track Ting Tong's journey all the way to Worlds.
Yeah, so keep up with Aspect of Gaming. Shout out to Bluestone Room and iPlay for being great venues, and congratulations to Ting Tong once again. You know, I hope you guys enjoy this VOD. Shout out to Blizzard as well for setting up the Fireside Gathering Championship as an entry for potential BlizzCon placings. So, you know, I'm really enjoying the scene at the moment. I cannot wait to see what comes next. So once again, it's been Pixie and Avril. Thank you guys so much for coming and listening, and I hope you've enjoyed the games. Cheers.